Hello and welcome to the Team VVV podcast for all your weekly racing game rambles. I'm Martin, and joining me as ever is Kevin.
Hi guys.
And Alan.
Hello viewers.
As ever, if you enjoy the podcast, do give us a like and subscribe. It really helps support what we do. So obviously this is the first podcast of 2017 from us, and it's going to be quite a significant year for racing games, I think it's fair to say. I got some big name releases like Forza Motorsport 7, Gran Turismo Sport, Project Cars 2, there's a new Need for Speed, and so on and so on. We'll be going into all that in a separate upcoming podcast. So, at first, I want to go back to Forza Horizon 3. I think it's fair to say someone from Microsoft's going to be in a spot of trouble.
Yeah, it's a pretty big whoops.
Yeah, as blunders go, this is pretty big. So an update came out for the PC version, but it seemed a bit large. I think it was like 50 gigabytes.
Yeah.
That's unusual. I mean, let's face it, patches nowadays are a bit too big sometimes, but 50 gig...
It's pushing
that's
it, yeah.
Significant. That is, yeah. I would be suspicious if that came out.
Yeah.
And it subsequently broke the game, pretty much. People lost their save games. And it also leaked some upcoming DLC content as well. So well done to whoever did that. We really admire that. That is how you start your first day back at work.
Oh, it's a terrible blunder, isn't it? I mean, if I was downloading this, I probably wouldn't have enough space on my hard drive for one thing. But
my Xbox One is 99% full up. I don't have that many games. It's shocking.
Yeah, exactly. So there's a massive list of cars on the website.
Just a few.
Unbelievable. I mean, we're talking probably about 40, 50 cars there. So I'm assuming these cars
that's probably the year's plan, basically, for Forza Horizon 3, just there. It's all there.
Exactly. It's all gone out the window now, isn't it?
And well, basically, it confirms our suspicions then that Porsche will be coming to Forza Horizon 3. No real surprise. It's been in Forza Horizon 2 and obviously Forza Motorsport 6.
Yeah.
Looking at the lists, I think the majority have featured in previous Forza games, which will probably annoy a few people.
Mm, yeah, I mean, it's a decent amount of Porsches there. I mean, we're talking probably about 15 or so Porsches, and you know, they do span several decades as well, so it's really good to see. But like you say, you know, if they're in previous games, then it's
a good selection, but considering it has been in Forza Horizon 2,
yeah, exactly, a bit underwhelming.
It's a bit of a shame, but there are some quite promising new cars that haven't actually been in Forza before. Obviously, there's a few new models like the 2017 Aston Martin DB11.
Yeah.
There's also a Lola as well, which is new to Forza. Lola T70, okay. 1969. A Jensen Interceptor. I like that.
Nice.
That is cruising. That would be cruising Australia in style. Australians probably never heard of the Jetson Interceptor, though.
No, probably not.
Yeah, that's a pretty obscure British car. Although, weirdly, it is very popular in America.
Mm.
I guess it's a very big car, though, let's be honest. It doesn't really suit narrow UK
roads.
It's
got that kind of sort of massive bonnet to it, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's very un-British, isn't it? Huge. I mean, the British cars, 60s and 70s, were very small, weren't they? You think of Lotus and things like that. And along comes Jensen with this massive big car, huge rear window, and it's like, wow.
Can you imagine driving that in London?
Yeah.
Well, driving anything in London's virtually impossible.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yeah. Not great for parking, put it that way.
No,
it's not the most car-friendly city in the world.
It is a cruiser, isn't it? But you know what? It's nice that they've got this massive... I mean, like, we've talked about it before, the range of cars, and what a great range they've put together. You know, it's a range of cars that's been put together by really passionate car fans. Mm-hmm. I think that's what's great about Forza Horizon. You can tell the passion that's gone into it from the dev team. Quality research.
In total, then, there's 54 unannounced vehicles here, by the looks of it. That's a lot more than I was expecting we'd see in Forza Horizon 3, if this does turn out to be true. I mean, we've had, four or five car packs, something like that? They generally released about six.
Yeah, that's right, and it just seems like there's far too many cars, doesn't it? I mean, I mean they've got, you know, Forza Motorsport 7 coming next year, so I can't imagine the two would clash in terms of sort of DLC packs. So you'd imagine they'd get the first sort of 6 months to maybe Forza Horizon 3 at most.
That's probably 5 to 6 months worth of content right there.
Yeah, so they'd have to really sort of squeeze all that out. long before Motorsport comes out, I imagine.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, very as usual, a very diverse selection. We look forward to that. Of course, we also have the release of the brand new Rockstar Energy pack this week, which of course featured the racing game debut of the BMW i8.
Mm.
Probably one of the most anticipated BMWs ever to come to a racing game, really. Again, it just shows how it just shows the sort of relationship they have with the manufacturers that they're able to release cars like this in such a timely manner, you know.
Yeah, there was a tweet, I have to say, it was quite funny. so, was it about it trying to poo out a Porsche 911? And you know, the funny thing is, when I looked at it, I could actually see what they were getting at. And yeah. Like, what has been seen cannot be unseen.
I know. So,
have you seen it, Kevin?
Yeah, I have. Yeah,
And it does look a bit strange when you look at it that way. It's quite funny.
It's not. Yeah. It's not for everyone, is it? The i8.
It's not. It's not. No. It depends on the angle. It has good angles. It has not so good angles as well. So, but you know, I like the way BMW have gone with the sort of concept car style with some of their new electric vehicles to differentiate them. It's a shame with the other one. I've seen the i3. Again, it's very, very sort of compact and upright and sort of stylish. Just interesting design. I like futurist sort of design in that way. So, but the rear of the car does look a bit strange. It has to be said. It's like it doesn't look very complete. It looks like a merge of two styles. I think that's why it looks a bit unusual.
Yeah, I'm not a great fan. I mean, like I said, from certain angles, it does look very good, but it certainly stands out though. You definitely notice it when it drives past.
Mm, absolutely, you do. Yeah.
it turns heads.
The sound. Yeah.
No, that's true. I mean, for me though, the highlight of the really was. Oh God, yeah.
I can really see the 911 being pooed out now.
You can see. What has been seen cannot be unseen.
Oh,
and I had to look at it when the chap mentioned it, and it just made me laugh at the time. You know, anyone you show that to will, you know, what has been seen. I mean, when one drives past me now, I just want to see how it looks in real life.
I've seen one in real life. They do exist.
They do. I've only ever seen them twice. I saw one in Cologne last summer at the Gamescom. There's one cruising around, and one in London about 3 months ago. And that's it. It's the only two times. I haven't seen many of them, surprisingly.
No, I think
they are around.
They're not in great supply, I don't think.
No. Well, there's they quite need a long waiting list. Pods as well, don't they? You know, they need a lot more charging points.
Yeah.
But, you know, BMW have made radical improvements. I mean, the you know, in terms of range, you know, the range anxiety issue, they're really sort of working on that. And the range of the cars is constantly improving in terms of how far they go, but how quick they charge as well. It's with radical improvements there. But really, we need cars that can do 300-mile range on a charge. You know, that's when you completely get rid of range anxiety.
Yeah. I mean, for me, the highlight of the pack really was probably the Ford Falcon. It doesn't get much more Australian than that.
No, exactly. I think all the packs are pretty decent. There's always a couple of cars that you like. It depends what you play for. Do you play to cruise? Do you want leaderboard cars? You know, that kind of thing. You know, I mean, it depends on what you're after out of a pack, really.
Yeah, I mean, it has something for everyone, doesn't it? Really, I mean, it has a muscle car. It has a Japanese car with the Nissan Skyline. You've got a pickup truck. Obviously got the i8 is the supercar. There's a track car and there's a Volvo as well.
Yeah,
lots to look forward to on Forza Horizon 3 then, judging from that leak, especially with the sort of influx of Porsches we're about to see. Yeah, which is also true in other racing game series as well. So obviously iRacing recently announced that Porsche is coming to the PC only racing simulation. That's quite big news for that series, it has to be said. I think that will make a lot of people happy.
Very much so. Excellent news. Good for Porsche, good for iRacing, good for sim racers. It's just a win-win-win.
Everyone wins,
Everyone wins. Massive following. Should be a great physics model. Look forward to seeing it. Yeah.
It's funny, isn't it, when obviously we had the announcement just a couple of weeks ago that the exclusive license with EA and Porsche was expiring, and everyone's sort of jumping on board.
Yeah. Yeah. And look at Porsche now. I mean, they've gone from zero to being everywhere. I mean, such a difference it's going to make for their exposure that they've been missing out on. Stacking some contract to VA. I hope it's been worth it for them, because they've missed out on an awful lot of exposure over the past.
They're basically playing catch-up. Well, 15 years worth of catch-up now, basically.
Yeah.
It's safe to say you're probably going to see Porsches crop up in every major racing franchise at the moment.
Yeah.
Obviously, there's still some to come in Assetto Corsa as well.
Yeah.
But will it come to Gran Turismo Sport?
I was just pondering that, actually. Yeah.
I saw a headline somewhere, I don't know where, that Porsche need to come to us, Kaz says, or something like that. You know, it's like, well, get off your high horse. For goodness sake. You know, if there's no Porsche in and the opportunities there, then that would be another bad move for GT.
Another great example of Gran Turismo being behind the times.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It wouldn't help them at this time. I mean, wow. We're going to talk about it when we talk about the year ahead next week, but
yeah.
There's going to be some titanic battles for the games market this year, for the racing market. I can't wait. Could really change the balance of power.
Yeah, that's it. I just realised, actually, we've actually technically been pronouncing Porsche wrong.
Yeah, Porsche.
It should be Porsche, shouldn't it?
Yeah, it should be.
You know, they actually released a video showing you how to pronounce it.
Well, if I'm to be technical, you're also pronouncing Forza Horizon 3 wrong as well. It's 3, not 3. There you go. It's got to be said, though, because you say free and three all the time.
Do I?
You do. Kevin does as well. It's got to be said.
It's a lifelong habit, and you know, it's very hard to change.
You guys. So. Porsche. There you go. I'll change Porsche. That.
We'll see how long it lasts.
Yeah. All of about 2 minutes, because I couldn't really care less. But carry on.
Probably.
It's like rough and roof.
No. I used to call it RUF and have done with it, you know.
And the only reason I brought it up was, like I said, there's actually an official video from Porsche saying how to pronounce it. It's like a 10-second long video.
Nice.
Right.
It just shows how fed up they are with people mispronouncing it, most of which probably in America.
Like, you know, it's similar to Fanatec. We used to call them Fanatec, but they're called Fanatec.
Yeah.
Even though they're not spelt that way.
And Nordschleifer. Yeah. I say Nordschleifer, but a lot of people say Nordschleife. But apparently the locals call it Nordschleifer, so that's good enough for me.
Nordschleifer, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Here we go. Of course, Porsche will also presumably be appearing in Project Cars 2.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's been a lot of news lately on Project Cars 2 on the official forum. Lots of teasing. Because, I mean, Slightly Mad Studios, they've been pretty silent about it since it was announced. Where are we now? About 2 years ago?
Exactly, yeah, 2 years ago. I mean, goodness me.
Well, there was a lot of uproar because the first game had barely been out, and then they suddenly announced the sequel because they need money.
Yeah.
That didn't go down very well. Obviously, it's worth remembering it's a very unconventional development, in that it's crowdfunded. But yeah, the news didn't go very well, and it's been silent ever since. Anyway, the sort of head honcho in Slightly Mad Studios has been hinting at what we can expect. There's a forum post where he basically says that all the three major manufacturers will be in the game, which of course you can only presume is Ferrari, Lamborghini, and Porsche. That's quite promising news. Because, I mean, the first game was lacking in road cars, wasn't it? I do hope we see a few more road cars in Project Cars too. It'd be great to see some, you know, Ferraris, Lamborghinis and Porsches in it.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I mean, you know, there was a massive racing focus, of course, with the motorsport career and whatnot. But, you say, it would have more character to the game, I feel, if it just has a little bit more sort of road cars and
iconic stuff. We'll talk about it a bit more in our 2017 preview. I mean, obviously, the whole point of the game, there will be new disciplines like rallying and hill climbs and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I must admit, I didn't expect Project Cars 2 to come out for quite a long time.
But
apparently, it might be out as early as September.
What a surprise.
I'm so surprised by that.
Yeah.
So apparently, it's going into quality assurance testing, which implies it's mostly done.
It's a lot of new content and cars and bits and pieces. I guess if they use the original as a foundation, then, you know, it could well be possible that they could bring it out this year. But, you know, we are surprised by the announcement. And
absolutely. Yeah, I mean, given the scale of the rumours that you hear, you know, we've heard that it's going to have off-road and everything else in it. It's very short development cycle, really, 2 years. It's not that long, given the fact that it took 4 years plus 5 years even to make the original game. I know they've had double the budget this time, or even quadruple the budget. And I know that they've literally, you know, built it from the ground up. They've made sure that every layer of it's perfect this time. And obviously there's chat on the forum there from Ian about how they've radically improved the handling, and thus force feedback has been improved a lot as well. So, and that, you know, with 7 months of additional testing, they'll have time to bring it all together this time. And I think that they really need to this time. You know, they are under a lot of pressure this time to, you know, put something together that solves the bugs that people encountered on the last game. You know, they cannot have another launch like that where they need a patch, you know, every week to try and get the bare minimum working. And I don't think they will. I think they know what they need to do. And I think hopefully they're willing to delay the game if it means making it as good as it can be. I'd be happy to see it delayed to make it as good as it can be. But the fact that they're bringing it together so quickly, really, again, you know, and the fact that, it, you know, like you say, coming out the same year as GT Sport, we'll talk more about that next week, but it's going to be interesting.
Oh, massive competition, you know, in those last sort of several months of the year. You know, if I was a set of Corsa now, developers, I'd be sweating on this a bit, and same with Gran Turismo Sport. So,
it's just especially surprising news when they've been so quiet about it.
Yeah,
I mean, there's been no details, no screenshots, no teaser videos, nothing.
It's almost sort of Dirt Rally esque, isn't it?
Yeah. A few screenshots have cropped up though, although we don't think they're official screenshots. It's come from some random forum in Poland, I think. We do intend to put them on the site, but it might be taken down by the time you hear this. We'll see.
Well, we will investigate the shots. I mean, I think that there's lots of different screenshots coming out. I mean, ideally, the problem is that whenever you're accepting somebody's word for it, you know, it's very difficult to verify information. It's also difficult to verify how old the screenshots are. These screenshots could be a year old, you know, it's really difficult to tell. So there's all of that.
They do lack a bit of polish, I think. To me, they do seem quite early, especially with the lighting. The lighting just looks a bit, I don't know, flat and uninspired.
Yeah.
It's impossible to judge until we get verification as to, you know, what stage of development the game was at that point, or if indeed the official screenshots at all.
Mm.
Particle effects do look promising, though. I think that is an area that they are improving quite a lot on in their Project Cars 2.
Mm, yeah. Mm. And, you know, things like that is like a VR killer, isn't it? So,
yes.
Yeah. If they are going to implement VR, then, you know, you imagine it'd be very much toned down, the effects, especially.
Yeah.
But, you know, a good range of environments in these shots. We've got some icy stages as well, which look interesting. Yep. I mean, very bare bones at the moment, but it looks like a ice sort of rally stage almost, doesn't it? It's
Yeah. Well, it looks like they're going to have rally. It looks like there's possibly some auto, some rally cross in there. Sorry. So, you know, it looks like a bit like Gran Turismo has a bit of rally, but not proper rally, does it? So, you know, you talk about biting off more than you can chew. Mm-hmm. You know, there's something I've seen there said about weather. They're going to have, as well as time of day, they're going to have time of year option, so you can race on it.
Season options, wasn't it?
Seasonal. Yeah. So, wow. You know, I mean, that's so much depth in terms of texturing and grip, and wow. Yeah, it's really. It seems like
a massive undertaking, isn't it?
Yeah. And the original game was a massive undertaking, and that was one of the things I loved about Project Cars, was the scale of what they set out to achieve, which moved the whole industry forward. One wonders whether they're biting off more than they can chew sometimes when they have so much to do and to bring together. And until they bring those parts together, that's when you're going to find out if it's going to work as well as they want it to.
Mm.
So, yeah, we suffice to say that we will try our best to get some hands on at some point.
Yeah, it's definitely ambitious, that's for sure. But all that progress in 2 years, and what's your excuse, Gran Turismo Sport?
Yeah, I know. I mean, in a year since the preview, they'll have done better textures, improved audio, and that's about better lighting, and that's about it. I mean, there's not a lot of improvement shown in Gran Turismo Sport at the moment.
More photo mode options, though.
Amazing photo mode options. It really is. I mean, if you're into photo mode, Gran Turismo will win. Well, I don't know. I mean, Project Cars was quite a formidable photo mode thing on PC. But, yeah, I mean, if you're into photo mode, wow. Yeah, you know, I think Gran Turismo is going to have you sorted. But if you're not into photo mode and you're actually into driving, well, we'll have to wait and see.
I guess the thing is, obviously, there's a lot of major racing games coming out this year with Project Cars 2, Gran Turismo Sport.
But we'll talk all about that next week, Martin.
Yeah, exactly.
Save it all up.
I think you just spoiled his segue there, haven't you? So he's laughing because it's true.
I had a segue planned for that.
Yeah. Want to start again?
I forgot what I was going to say now.
Oh, goodness. Right, should we go to the next one then?
I can remember. So, yeah, lots to look forward to this year. We've got, you know, Project Cars 2, Gran Turismo Sport, etc. But the question is, how will current games react, such as Assetto Corsa? Well, apparently by adding lots and lots of new content, including what we got here, customizable championships, private lobbies are coming, and also lots of free content, including Laguna Seca. That is, yeah, I mean, that is how you do it.
Yeah, it's almost like a statement, is it, at the beginning of the year to say, you know, we're still here, we're still fighting away, because they're going to be under massive pressure. We've got some, like you say, some huge releases this year. And Assetto Corsa, you know, they've really got to up their game because they're going to be really trailing otherwise. And, you know, they could be dead by the end of the year if they don't, you know, on the console market, that is, if they don't get their act together. Yeah. And, you know, it's all well and good with all this content. I'm just a little bit worried that can they keep up with the console versions? You know, we're seeing massive drops in numbers on Assetto Corsa on the consoles already. You know, you've only got to look at the online lobbies to see that. It's a, you know, real shame. And if they're already falling behind several times with content compared to the PC version, I just worry that they just will continue that trend. And a lot of this content, you know, the console players will have to wait longer for. And that's not good enough, because they're going to be under severe pressure from the likes of Forza and GT and Project Cars. And, you know, that's only half of the pretty big titles that are coming out as well. So, you know,
there is a big danger, I think, of Assetto Corsa being kind of left behind, I think, by the competition in that sense.
Absolutely.
It's basically, they don't have the resources that most of the other developers do have.
No.
You know, even the team at Slightly Mad Studios is, you know, a lot bigger than Kunos.
I mean, I read their blog recently, and they said that they really stretched themselves to the limit to release the console versions. And you could see that, can't you? Because they are falling behind consistently with content packs and whatnot. So I'm a little bit worried for them. I'm excited for the content, certainly. Definitely excited for Assetto Corsa in 2017, but I am a little bit concerned for the development team that, you know, they might be falling behind even further. I wish them well, of course, because I want to get the best possible experience from Assetto Corsa on the consoles, but I guess we'll just have to wait and see.
It depends on, you know, whether they've sold enough to be relatively profitable already on console. I mean, it's quite possible they have, but either way, you know, the team is obviously at the limit. They need more resource, and obviously depending on when they get a return on their initial sales, then perhaps they can get more people in to develop more and redevelop the game. But like you say, if they haven't done it in 6 months from now and they haven't made a big difference, well, it's going to get pretty competitive in that racing market.
That's the problem. Like I said, there's a real danger, I think, of it being left behind there, but they are supporting it well, all things considered. There is some quite promising content there. lots of free content as well. It's not all bad news.
No, it's not all bad news. I mean, on the PC, it's great. I mean, they've got a good fan base on the PC. That isn't going anywhere. So they've got a solid base. It's just, can they build on the console content between now and... Because the problem is, if the community that's on Assetto Corsa leave and they lose their hardcore community, then, you know, it all depends, really. I mean, we don't know how good the handling's going to be in in GT Sport when it's out, or Project Cars 2. And Project Cars 2 is a complete mystery. That could be a lot closer to Assetto Corsa this time. Mm. I mean, the thing about it is the handling in Project Cars wasn't as detailed as Assetto Corsa before. But when I drove the same cars on the same circuits, I would generally be braking in the same places. I mean, the actual input was the same. It's just that the detail wasn't there. If they can improve upon that, then it's only going to close that gap.
I mean, considering what they're, you know, where they've come from, the Shift series of titles and the old test drive stuff. I mean, was it Ferrari Racing Legends, Slightly Mad, done before? I mean, considering where they've come from, Project Cars, for me, was a real surprise in terms of depth to the handling model. And, you know, they can only improve, really. And you know, certainly we're looking for Project Cars 2 to be more sort of Assetto Corsa and sort of less sort of Gran Turismo-y. Yes.
I generally think the Project Cars basically transformed the racer game industry on console. Without Project Cars, there probably would have been no Assetto Corsa on console.
Absolutely, yeah. They were definitely the torchbearers. And, you know, such a huge package as well on launch. Okay, it had its problems, sure. But like you said earlier on, Alan, it was so you know, ambitious. And just to have the guts to do this, they definitely deserve commending.
Absolutely. You know, I mean, and playing Project Cars, you know, on the Xbox the other day, you know, I'm still impressed with what they've managed to get out of the Xbox. They've improved upon it a lot, upon the earlier builds and everything. I mean, it's really come a long way. So still impressed with what they've put together. So, I mean, a foundation to build upon for sure in terms of the second one. But yeah, I look forward to seeing previews. You know, maybe it's going to be some months before we hear much about it officially, you know, but hopefully right Easter, one would expect a trailer around that time, and then hopefully seeing more at E3.
Yep, exciting times. Going back to Assetto Corsa, though, I'm slightly skeptical about some of the car content, because so they're releasing what they're calling the British pack, which has lots of McLarens and Lotuses, but do we need any more Lotuses?
No, because there was two categories for Lotus. There was the modern Lotuses and the old one. Is it Lotuses or is it Lotai? Yeah,
there's more Lotuses than anything else in that game. I don't know why.
Yeah.
It's the same story for Ferrari as well. They're going to release another 7 Ferraris. Again, I don't think we need any more Ferraris. We need some Aston Martins, damn it.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I guess it's surprising to see all these Lotuses from an Italian developer. So that's kind of good. But yeah, too many of one British brand. That's the problem, isn't it? We need a bit more sort of diversity, a bit more spread out.
You know, a bit more range. I think the problem is that what happens is sometimes is they do a deal with one car company, and then that car company says, right, you need to take our whole range, and they're obliged to do it. Sometimes I see all these extra Lotuses, and I think, actually, I'd rather that resource had been used bringing in some different cars from other manufacturers, maybe. But, you know, it is what it is, isn't it? So, you know, they're busy working on their Porsche selection, of course, and getting all that out first, plus other game improvements. There's a lot to do.
Well, they're busy trying to open a new studio as well, which is interesting. Yes,
I'm glad you got to that, because there is a mention of VR, which is very exciting.
That'll be good. I mean, it still doesn't work with the Vive yet, which is a shame.
I was going to say, that's probably going to be PC only, I imagine. Isn't it?
Yes. Mm. I mean, the future is VR, isn't it? And I think if you start developing for VR now, when you get PS5, and Xbox, whatever it's going to be called by then, you know, it's going to be amazing.
Yeah, I mean, it's very conceivable that they could release a Assetto Corsa on the PS5, couldn't they, as a sort of updated package?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's, if they keep building on it in a sort of modular way, then it could be something that just continues to expand on future generations. A bit like iRacing, I suppose.
It does beg the question, like, will we see more racing sims on the consoles? You know, if they can pull this off, Assetto Corsa, and, like you say, develop in stages, you know, it's an interesting way of doing business. And,
depends on the publisher, probably, how much faith the publisher has in what they're doing, and how consistent sales continue, whether they consistently keep selling. You know, and as I say, you know, what more content they can bring in that's going to, you know, wow people. You know, because I mean, if you look across the market, you know, whether it's Assetto Corsa, whether it's Race from Racing Experience, whether it's Project Cars, You know, there's loads of new content coming out for everybody's games right now. You know, it's a really exciting time.
No, I mean, it's never been a better time really to be a racing game fan, no. Basically.
No, absolutely.
So much choice. I mean, going back a few years, there was so much talk about the racing genre being almost in danger because there was a lot. Yeah. There was a lot of games that flopped quite badly and led to studio closures and stuff like that. And suddenly, it's booming. It's great.
2009, 10. When I decided to launch a racing gaming only website, the bottom fell out of the industry. You know, Split Second Studio went out of business. Blur died and went out of business. No more Project Cars. It was very hard going at the time. You know, we had one game a quarter to work on. And we had to rinse those games basically just to have some coverage. So now you've got so much indie stuff, and it's amazing now.
Ironic that at that point you were probably relying on Gran Turismo because it was the only game out.
Well, sort of, yeah. I mean, you know, up until the hard part was before that. I think we had Superstars V8 from Milestone. Mm-hmm. We had WRC1 from Milestone. We had, you know, that was about it for like basically a year until F1 2010 came out. And, you know, obviously that was that for a year until F1 2011. And between then, it was very tricky, you know, trying to cover stuff. I didn't have a gaming PC, so I couldn't cover any PC stuff. So it was pretty hard going at that time. But now, you know, it's just so much stuff out there. It's amazing. And it's not just how much is out there, it's how many cars and tracks and details are packed into each game as well. You know, it's never been so good, you know, put it that way. Never been so competitive. And that's great because it's driving everybody forward to improve their games.
It compels them to improve. So I guess one other studio that kind of remained in silence about their new project is, of course, Codemasters. They probably won't release their new IP this year, but who knows. But weirdly, there was news this week that Dirt 3, F1 2013, and Grid have been taken off Steam out of nowhere, which was surprising. Mm. Grid, I guess, is an old game, but even so, it has quite a loyal fan base.
Well, I mean, there might be some licensing issues, some licensing renewals that need to be done for those titles. Yeah. It seems very unusual that for games that have sold so well, made millions and millions and millions of pounds, to then be taken off sale because licensing has expired seems very strange to me. I'm sure they've looked at the numbers of what they're selling via the numbers of what they're making and expenditure and decided we're not going to do this anymore. But it does seem to be a very strange move, it has to be said.
Yeah. I mean, there are games that expire and then they don't actually come back. So
no.
Yeah, like what was it, Outrun Online Arcade on PS3?
Right, yeah.
That vanished because of their license with Ferrari expired.
Yeah.
And never seen again.
Which is strange, isn't it? You know, when a product's been made. Can you imagine if movies were like that and suddenly those films just weren't available anymore because, you know, licenses.
If you only watch films on Netflix, that does happen.
Yeah, I guess on Netflix, exactly. So a strange one in the modern day when you have products that clearly do still sell. I mean, I'd say half the world probably owns them now. Most of the people that are going to buy them have bought them. But having said that, whenever there's a sale, I'm sure they sell a few hundred here and there every time. And it still seems a bit unusual. But yeah.
I mean, in the case of F1 2013, could it be something to do with the classic content?
It could be. You know, I have no idea. It could be classic content. You'd have to say classic content is the only thing that separates it, and they've decided to get rid of it because of that. So that would be the standout issue.
Dirt 3, likewise, could be the Gymkhana content, because obviously Kenbox now associated with Forza.
That's probably a good point there, yep.
Yeah, but then in which case, shouldn't Dirt 2 be off Steam as well?
Doesn't have Gymkhana in it, though, specific Gymkhana. The Gymkhana license might be different, you see, because it's so big on YouTube. So that might be something they'll have to pay for separately.
Actually, looking at this, the link to Dirt 2 on Steam doesn't work.
And it might be that Gymkhana will appear in another game, a new game coming up. So
that wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, I mean, that could be a Ken Block issue because Ken is obviously part of Need for Speed. And that's EA. So,
well, no, he's with Forza now, isn't he?
Oh, he's with Forza now, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's moving about, he's whoring himself around.
Yeah, he is a bit.
I mean, I guess if someone's going to do a Gymkhana experience in the future, so who knows, there might be a new Gymkhana experience coming in a game later this year. Perhaps
you can almost see a whole separate game coming out for that.
Nearly, yeah. I mean, they could get away with it. But it'd need more than just Gymkhana, I think.
Yeah. As long as they don't call it something like Ken Block the game.
Ken
like,
Block.
Like Valentino Rossi the game. Ken Block the game.
And God knows what we'll get with that. Tiddlywinks or something. Or different disciplines.
No, I bet that is the game that Milestone are holding back at the moment. That is their new surprise game, I think.
It'd be like Ken Block the game. Yeah.
Yeah. So you heard it here first. Milestone's new game will be Ken Block the game. So yeah, no doubt there'll be plenty of indie racing game surprises as well this week, this year. This week there was a few new releases. We had the release of Acro Storm, which is a kind of sort of F-Zero kind of knockoff. It was supposed to come out on Wii U, but it's, well, let's face it, the Wii U doesn't, it's basically extinct now, so they've just released it on Steam Early Access. Don't really know what to think about that game. It looks like it needs a lot of work, I think it's a polite way to say it.
Yes, it still looks pretty early on. They realise what the problems are with it. I mean, there are some major bugs in that first release. I'm not sure if they've actually updated it already. They may have done, actually. But, I mean, it does look a little bit stiff when the jets are going around the corners.
There's no animation on the riders, for example, is there, when you go around the corners?
No, it just seems like... I don't know, it's like they're getting it online just to see the community feedback, basically, and just sort of develop the title from the feedback, I guess. It's got some interesting parts. There are some interesting environmental details here and there. But it's got a long way to go. I mean, it'll be in Steam Early Access probably for at least a year, and we'll just have to sort of keep up to date with it and see how it develops.
Yeah, I just get the impression it would have done better if it came out a few years ago.
Yeah, I guess so, yeah.
That's the problem, but we'll keep an eye on it anyway. No doubt it will develop, but it has been in development for quite a long time now.
It does seem like a long, long time, doesn't it? I think I was covering this title pretty much when I joined the VV team about 2 years ago. So, best part of 2 years ago now. So, yeah, it has been a while. And, it has come a long way, definitely, but it still has some way to go.
Now, one game that has come a long way, though, I think, is Formula Fusion, judging by the new trailer.
Yeah,
that does look very promising. It's just a shame it's colliding right into Wipeout Omega Collection this year.
Yeah, I mean, we've got a video that's going to come out in the next few days, next week or whatever, looking at the new update on Formula Fusion. So, but generally speaking, the cross-section visuals have been improved since the last build, new circuit, cockpit cam. Handling is my issue. I've still got an issue with handling a track design, but I'm going to outline that more in the video. Suffice to say that it's better, but it's still not there yet.
Does it live up to its sort of aim to be a kind of modern version of Wipeout, would you say, at this point, or not?
It's got lots of great things in place if they make the changes they need to make. But if they don't, it will be either, you know, I mean, some of the circuits are too narrow in some places. You know, you've got AI bumping into walls, and then of course you've got nowhere to go because the circuit's so narrow. So you're just grinding with AI around the corners, and the actual way the cars float isn't quite right. The actual sort of floating feeling is off, and you know, handling in general is just not quite there yet. The physics regarding how they levitate. So they've got at the moment, it's got nice visuals. It's much more intense now. But they've got to make these changes. I watched an expert playing one of the circuits, and he was still bumping off the odd walls here and there. And that was just when he's racing around on his own in a time trial. I mean, when you're in a race, you're being pushed into walls left, right, and centre. It's got potential, but it's a shame. You know, it's frustrating at the moment. I hope they can get on top of those elements, but they do need to make the circuit changes. If they don't, and I don't think they're going to, that's the disappointing thing. And it's not changing the whole circuit. it's changing a few corners. Like when you come around a bend and you know it needs a bit of extra runoff for that bend so you can flow around the corner with your inertia. And it's just a few corners where you're just like, well, I've got to go so slowly, and then you just completely lose your flow. So, yeah, it's not as good as Wipeout on the PS1 in that sense, in terms of overall inertia. And they've not found the model yet. So still work to be done, but it has moved on a long way. So, you know, it's still going to be a fun game to play.
So I think it has potential then. Like I said, it's just a big shame. I think it's coming out the same year that Wipeout is making its comeback on PS4. That's some pretty stiff competition. The game that inspired it is coming out the same year.
Yeah, as is Redout, you know. And I think Redout's also going to interest people, you know, when it actually comes out. It depends how well it runs, but if it runs as well as it could run and should run, I think that will be another exciting addition to the market. So, but overall, obviously, Wipeout is by far the most established brand there, and worth more than either of them. But if it creates a market that helps all of them, there's easily enough to go around. It's just a shame they're all releasing at the same time. You know, we had nothing for the last 2.5 years, and suddenly, bosh, they're all going to be out within 6 months of each other.
Madness. Mm. It's interesting because we're seeing a lot of these kind of, you know, retro-inspired games that, you know, sort of big developers just aren't touching anymore. One that really captured my eye was Grip. That's had a new update as well. And again, that seemed to have come quite a long way since the last update. Have you been playing that lately as well?
Been playing Grip. Grip has improved a lot as well. In fact, they took on board a lot of what I talked about early in development. It's more playable now. There's still a few things here and there they need to work on, which I'm going to talk about in the video, which is to do with understeer of the car at speed. Inability to turn the car at speed is a real problem. So, for example, not only are you understeering, but if you hit the brakes or if you come off the power, there's no weight distribution. You can't get the back end out and power slide it through a corner. So it's needs a few tweaks in handling. Also, when you're in the air, I kind of wish there was you're constantly getting knocked by things and you end up facing the wrong way. And just now and again, it's like, if only there was something I could do, like to you know, alter that my chances when I'm in the air. Otherwise, you're just sort of helpless flying through the air, and then you smack in a wall and you're facing the wrong way, and then it's all over. But I will say I've had enormous fun on it so far. It's got great potential, but it's very hard. And it might look easy to some people in a video. It's certainly not easy. It's you know, there's bumps and everything that can send you off course. It's very tricky. But the scale, the design, the visual look, very, very impressed. Of all the indie games coming out this year, it's currently my most sought-after indie title so far this year.
Yeah.
So, yeah, absolutely. They've definitely got most of the components going in the right places. There's a new test track, actually, on the current build where you're flipping around here, there, and everywhere. It's brilliant. Love it, you know, and it's some really cool ideas that they're trying out now. So it's going to be very challenging, I can tell you that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we look forward to seeing how that develops then. That's also coming out at some point this year. One other franchise that might be making a comeback, judging by a tweet we spotted a few weeks ago, Tokyo Highway Challenge. This was not something we were expecting to see. Again, it's not being announced just yet, but we are expecting an announcement this week. So obviously check out the news section of the website for updates on that. But that would be quite an interesting comeback, I think. It's been quite a long time since we've seen any game in that series. What was the last one? Was it Importuna something?
Challenge, yeah. That was the one. Yeah. 2008, was it?
Yeah,
it's been a decade.
2006.
The genre of Tokyo Highway battle games has been going around for some time. I mean, they first came to the fore on the Sega Saturn. They were really rubbish on the Sega Saturn, frankly. Shifty graphics, as I call them. I have Tokyo Highway Battle on the Sega Dreamcast, which ran at 60 frames per second, I might add. It was. You know, I got it as a technical demo, but in a way, Tokyo Highway Challenge, they're very much from the Battle Gear ilk, really. You know, the the midnight races in Tokyo. And for the most part, you know, I'd say a lot of them are pretty dull. They haven't been terribly exciting. They've not lived up to their true potential. I think one of the reasons is there's not enough variety in the types of traffic and stuff like that. There's not enough variety in the actual freeways that they've modeled and stuff. It needs to have a challenge that's unique to every drive. And I think it would bring a lot more to it. So it's got potential, but, you know, graphically, what are we targeting here? Are we thinking Gran Turismo, or are we thinking Milestone? And I, unfortunately, you know, Big Ben, I think we're thinking more of something like that. I hope not. I hope they can make it graphically better than that. I mean, they might be targeting arcade machine from 5 years ago style or something. That would work better than... I'd rather a very smooth game that ran really well over 30 frames, you know, something like that. But let's just wait and see. I mean, I'm excited about it because I like the way it's something new from a new developer. I just, you know, keep it tempered because it could turn out to be absolute rubbish.
Mm. Yeah. It could well be just another arcade sequel.
Arcade sequel mobile game, exactly. Yeah. Just never know.
A bit like... Daytona USA 3, which we're
Daytona USA 3. Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that. And, you know, in fact, I think it's going to be amazing, that video. I'm going to tell you just how brilliant it is. Oh, yes. Yes. I cannot wait. Oh, my goodness. Daytona 3. We'll save that for the end of the day. Yeah.
Yeah, you can tell we're very, very excited about that one.
Absolutely.
Anyway, as for new releases, we're literally 1 week into the first month of the year, and there has technically been a new release in the racing genre, but it's a very sort of stealth release, really. It's we've mentioned it before, obviously, MX versus ATV Supercross Encore 2017 edition, except we don't think it's coming out to the UK, so we probably shouldn't bother talking about it.
No. No, let's just not talk about it.
Basically, to put it simply, it's a re-release of a re-release.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think it's got a fan base, isn't it? And I think that, you know, it's just a bit dated looking, and it's living on the fan base from what we've seen in the trailer, rather than bringing anything new. I know we keep hearing about developers not having enough funding to do much more with it. But, you know, if there's not enough market out there, then that's it. You know, these games have made a lot of income in the past. Wherever that income went, who knows? But, you know, if it's not keeping up with the market technology, then the experience people expect, then it's just going to fall behind.
No, exactly. I mean, it's, like I said, it's a re-release of a re-release. It needs a proper sequel with a new engine, ideally.
Absolutely, yeah.
Which is a shame, because the games in that series did used to be quite good. Was it MX versus ATV Alive? I think was the last one I played, the last good one. I think that's what it was called, or Reflex. Anyway, just to move it on, then, just to finish up. Did any of you guys see the Grand Tour over Christmas?
No.
No.
It was just me then.
Yes. Was it good? Was it good?
Okay, so yeah, the one that aired over the week of Christmas, that was very good. I would probably say that was possibly the best in the series because it was actually about cars.
Yeah.
You have the new Mustang versus the Focus RS. That was very good.
Yeah.
And James May also did quite an interesting piece about Ford's battle with Ferrari in Le Mans, and it was so different. It was actually quite jarring because it was almost like a mini documentary. It was unlike anything that we've seen in the Grand Tour. It was an actual piece of serious car journalism. I recommend watching that one. Of course, you have the usual kind of studio bits with, obviously, it's Christmas. If you remember in Top Gear, they used to have this section in the news over Christmas where they sort of try out different novelty gift ideas for car enthusiasts. They did the same thing, basically, in this. One thing I'm noticing in the Grand Tour, though, there's a lot of dick jokes all the time.
I was going to say about innuendo. Was there a lot of innuendo?
So many.
Yeah.
And they're not very subtle.
No, I remember the Top Gear when they had like the sort of advertisements on the car, And it was very stealthily done, but when you spotted it, you know, you couldn't unsee it. And
there was one as well. They were doing donuts on a big open area of concrete or something, and you're like, "What are they doing?" And then the camera pulled out.
Mm. It's interesting you say about the subtle kind of adverts on banners and stuff like that. They did the same thing in this in the Grand Tour. They said it was on their shirts, and it wasn't subtle at all. I'm sure you can guess what it's spelled out.
Mm. Yeah, probably. depends on who it was on, I guess.
Yeah, that's true. And of course, there was another celebrity death.
Nice.
I don't know why they keep making that a recurring joke. Other than that, I would say that is the best episode so far. The one afterwards, we had the traditional sort of New Year special. It was a one long road trip through South Africa that dominated the two episodes. Mm. And I must say, it was very, very dull.
Oh.
I can't even think of anything to talk about. It was that dull. It was just literally driving in beach buggies through a desert for 2 hours.
They just can't seem to find any momentum, can they? It's
no. I mean, my main problem with it, so that they're in a bunch of beach buggies basically, but they just weren't very interesting to watch. Like the whole appeal of, I think, the extended road trips is you see the presenter's connection, a connection develop between the car and the presenter.
Yeah,
like for example, do you remember Oliver Botswana special? There's nothing like that in this episode at all. It just felt very disconnected, and there's some very scripted comedy again.
The problem is it's so scripted now, and it's such big budget that the presenters aren't having to work enough at it. They're turning up, they're doing their bit, they're walking off back to their trailer, and that's it. And they're not really caring enough about what they're doing now. And I think they've got too big for their own boots. I mean, that's how it seems to come across. You know, they're not the same people they were when they came into it, and they don't share the same level of passion now that they had when they came into it. And they've forgotten clearly by the quality struggling is they've forgotten what made them great. And you know, maybe there were people behind the scenes at Top Gear. Some of the production guys and stuff like that who did incredible work at making them look great. And now they have to do it all themselves, you know, without some of those production guys, they're struggling for ideas.
Yeah, that's it. But I think in the case of the special, though, I think it's one of those episodes that sounded good at the time. And they probably had fun making it, but it just wasn't fun to watch at all.
No. I wonder how it's done, though, in terms of performance. I wonder how many people have bought Amazon Prime just to...
Well, we know it's the most successful show of all time, which anyone could have guessed, but they don't release viewing figures, so we'll never know.
No, they don't. And I'd be interested to. I'd love to know how many people bought Amazon Prime just for the Grand Tour. I mean, no doubt it's huge. I mean, because it's a global thing.
But yeah, that's it. It's available worldwide now as well, so it has a massive, massive audience.
Mm. But Top Gear is going to be back in a while.
Yeah, there was actually a teaser release for that. I don't know if you guys saw it.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It was literally about 15 seconds long, but it was so much better without Chris Evans, I have to say.
Yeah, the whole show will be better without Chris Evans. You know, they've got an opportunity. They need to create a bond between each other. They need time together. And, you know, dare I say, the only problem with Top Gear is that, as Matt LeBlanc has already said, is that he doesn't like doing unscripted stuff. He's much more comfortable with a script. He said that, you know. And there's a part of me that says, yeah, that's the problem right there. Unfortunately, you need people who are good at working without a script. Yes, you need people who can link together and do the script when they need to. But you also need people who just, let's just have a drive and just start filming it and having a laugh. And there's something so genuine about that. And mixing prepared jokes and prepared stuff along with the unexpected. And you end up with a much more genuine encounter, you know.
No, I agree. But I suppose in Matt LeBlanc's case, he does have an advantage in that he's an actor, so he can kind of pull it off. Whereas, you know, Jeremy, James, and Richard are not actors, and it's so obvious when it's staged. It's just cringeworthy sometimes. And unfortunately, this special was another example of that because I felt no connection with the cars. I just didn't care when they kept breaking down. It's the same old formula. They play pranks on each other. They constantly break down. They go through some rough terrain. They nearly die.
Yeah.
In inverted commas.
Yeah.
And it was just that for 2 hours, two hours straight. Right. Anyway, just to finish up, we're going to go to some questions now. We've got a few questions over on Facebook. This first one comes from Stephen Wood. He asks, what game in 2017 are you most excited about? Probably could have guessed that someone would ask that. Good question. There's so much to choose from. For a personal point, I'm very excited about the release of Rackfest. You know, it's been so long since we've had a true sort of Destruction Derby-esque title.
Absolutely, yeah. Wreckfest for me is definitely one of those. If it stays sort of true to the sort of Destruction Derby sort of ethos, then that would certainly be a cracking title that I'll be looking forward to.
Again, I keep saying it, but it has by far and away the most advanced damage modelling we've ever seen since Burnout Paradise, frankly. And that came out nearly 10 years ago.
Yeah, I mean, you've got to temper your expectations a little because I don't imagine we'll get nearly as good a model in the final game, but... yeah, certainly really looking forward to that one.
They did turn it down a little bit compared to the sort of alpha thing they did. I forget what it's called now. the sort of alpha demo they released about 3 years ago. But even so, the soft body damage modeling is just leagues above anything else at the moment.
Yeah.
And again, of course, it's not licensed cars, so they have that sort of freedom. Mm. I mean, that's my pick. Anything come to mind, Alan?
For games I'm looking forward to this year,
yeah, I guess we're going to go into this a bit more in our preview.
Yeah, podcast, I would say that we'll talk a bit about. It. I mean, I think from a personal point of view, I look forward to Project Cars 2 because now what else is there? Project Cars 2, a couple of unannounced titles that I'm interested in, which we're not going to talk about.
I mean, Ken Block the game.
Ken Block the game, yeah. So there's a couple of unannounced titles. Project Cars 2 is curious and interesting. I think that's something that interests me. But yeah, there's a couple of other unannounced racing games I'm looking forward to this year as well. But we'll talk a bit about that. This is a big year. And you know what? I am looking forward to going to some Sport.
Yeah.
I'm sure it'll be fun to play. I just hope it's got, I know what it is. My expectations are tempered. I just hope it's as good as it can be. It won't be as good as I want it to be, but I hope it's still as decent as it can be.
Kevin, I guess I'm looking forward to TT Isle of Man.
I was thinking of myself, funny enough, yeah.
Wipeout Omega Collection as well. And I guess GT Sport, as long as they can pull off a sort of, a disciplined sort of online racing environment, then that could be a really good sort of go-to game for some online racing.
Yeah, I'll say, well, at least one thing you can say about Gran Turismo Sport, it will be bringing esports to console gamers.
Mm. I'm just a little bit worried that they might not pull it off because it's such a complicated thing to pull off successfully, and we'll have to wait and see.
Yeah, that's the problem. But at least they'll have a good photo mode.
Great photo mode. I mean, wow. Car companies are going to love that. That's all I can see it now. The Shayna car companies, look at the wonderful pictures of your cars that you'll be able to show.
Oh my God, it's so realistic. I can't tell. It's from the game. It looks like real life.
Exactly. That's what it's going to be.
You can see it, can't you? Yeah. Next question. Yi Long says, what are you hoping for when it comes to Dirt Rally 2? Some actual content would be a good start.
More tracks, more rally cross. I guess more sort of variety in weather types. The sound we know is going to be great. The graphics are going to be very decent. So yeah, it's just basically down to content that game is really missing, because I think the physics, the sound, and the graphics are pretty spot on.
It needs more locations, I would say. That's the big thing for me.
Yeah.
I mean, for me, there's a few things that I'd like to see improved. I never felt the feeling of speed was quite right in the game. It was better in the final game, but it still didn't quite feel quite right to me at times. And there's a feeling on certain surfaces that I felt were a little bit, you didn't feel you're going fast enough. They're a bit over bumpy, or they didn't, the gravel or something didn't quite feel right. So there's little changes that need to be made. I mean, there is improvements to physics that can be made, and I hope that they achieve those. But fundamentally, it's just content. They need a ton more content this time. And I think if they can do that, then it will be just the best rally thing out there. Project Cars are going into rally as well. Very interesting to see what Project Cars 2 does with rally and how that affects the rally market, because it means you'll have Dirt Rally 2, WRC 7, Project Cars Rally, Gran Turismo Rally mode. There's a lot coming.
I'm sorry, Project Cars 2 Rally, I think it'll definitely be good if they actually sort of utilize an actual, you know, the expertise of an actual rally driver or a co-driver, just like Dirt Rally and obviously Sebastian Loeb Rally did, and and also WRC6. I think that would be a big factor personally, because obviously they made a big thing about you know, taking advice from Ben Collins to get the physics just right and things like that. I think they need to do something like that if they're gonna do it properly.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm sure they've got the right people, I mean, to talk to there to get it just right. And I suppose from Ben Collins' point of view, you know, from the fundamental car handling, I mean, you know, that guy's driven so many cars. He knows so much about how things should handle.
Yeah, I mean, who better to ask than the Stig, who's driven every car known to man on top of you.
Exactly. I mean, the feedback must be amazing that they get from him. So there's so much potential there. But yeah, wow, what a competitive year. And we don't even know the games that are coming out yet. They're still the secret games.
Yeah, that's it. So moving on to Adam Lee. He says, what's your favorite piece of sim racing hardware that you have used? Mine is my current GT Omega rig with Thrustmaster TX wheel with the various rims. Well, Alan has quite a collection of steering wheels. So he's probably best to answer
question. That is a question, isn't it?
That is a question. Is it going to be the Logitech G225?
Well, in terms of wheels, I love my G25. I've actually grown to love my T500 with the new rims. I've been using that for 5 years, and I love the T500. I love the T500 pedals. But in terms of rigs, that's a more difficult question. I've been in so many different rigs. Though one thing that was different to everything else was the Motion Simulations TL1 simulator, which I tried a few years ago. And it's a wraparound projection system. When I was in there, it felt really comfortable, really immersive. I didn't want to get out again. And that was a pretty impressive simulation. It was running iRacing. And I thought that was pretty darn impressive. Since I've tested it, I mean, they've improved it radically as well. And it was a really impressive piece of kit. But rigs wise, yeah, I mean, I've used so many different rigs. I suppose, you know, my favorite personal home rig was the R-Seat Evo rig that I got a few years ago. It's not as big as the RS1 that I have currently, but it was more comfortable. They don't sell it anymore, R-Seat, surprisingly, but it is the most comfortable compact rig they've ever built. Very strange decision to stop selling it, I felt. But yeah, that was a good one. And as for the wheels right now, well, we've got the TC, TSPC wheel from Thrustmaster. We've got the equally brilliant Fanatec CSL Elite wheel. And, you know, they are just amazing pieces of kit. So, you know, I can't complain. I've been very lucky to have tested a lot of different products, but some standouts there.
And finally, on Twitter, Adam McCann says, if Dirt Rally was to do a DLC, what countries and cars would you like to see in it? Ooh, good question. There was a lot of missing content in Dirt Rally, wasn't there? And some of which was in other games like Sebastian Loeb and WRC6. I guess you've got locations like was it Italy in Sebastian Loeb? That wasn't in Dirt Rally. Australia.
I will just say, I mean, I think Australia is a great rally, but also a rally I've always enjoyed in games is New Zealand. I always enjoyed the kind of gravelly, slidey nature of it. And I always enjoyed that. I always thought that was a great rally. So I'd love to see that make a return. And if you go back to Colin McRae, the original Colin McRae on the PS1, the game opened with the New Zealand stages. Yeah.
That was special, wasn't it?
Oh, it was amazing at the time. Absolutely amazing. And ever since then, and then when I played New Zealand again in WRC3, they basically modelled the Colin McRae stage. It played the same.
The Colin McRae, it really sort of captured that sort of damp essence, didn't it? The dirt, side of the track and pieces like that. Wow, incredible game.
Amazing. So, that's a rally I'd like to see. But other than that, it's just general range and variety, I think. Looking at some of the different sort of rallies that are in there.
Well, in terms of cars as well, there's quite a few sort of iconic cars that were missing that were in, again, in Sebastian Loeb Rally, like like the Toyota Celica, for example.
Yeah, I mean, I'd love to see a classic rally car DLC pack, basically, that just fills the gaps that Dirt Rally currently has.
Yeah, I mean, it had a few Group B cars and, you know, things like that.
Yeah.
It didn't have a Renault. Did it have the Renault 5 Turbo? I don't think it did it?
No, I don't think so, no.
Yeah, so just things like that. Obviously, a lot of WRC cars are missing as well, but that's probably due to, you know, licensing restrictions.
Yeah. I mean, you know, and the modern WRC cars, I mean, the new season, they're going to be cracking. They're going to get, you know, more power and stuff. But in terms of the sort of 2016 and before, you know, they're not that interesting, are they, compared to sort of the classic rally stuff? Doesn't really capture the imagination.
That was one of my criticisms with WRC 6. Obviously, it's not really their fault as such, because it is, they have to follow the, you know, the current championship. But they were just all dull hatchbacks.
Yeah, I mean, that's really what I'm looking forward to.
Drive.
Exactly. So this year's cars hopefully will sort of rekindle the rally sort of sport. More powerful cars. You know, not quite Group B, but, you know, it's bridging the gap a little bit to the Group B sort of monsters. So it'd be interesting to see how it turns out.
Yeah, with that in mind, I hope we do see a new WRC game.
Well, yeah, hopefully, yeah. Yeah, we're just assuming there will be, but yeah, you never know.
In some ways, this year really warrants one more than last year.
Yeah,
in a way.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, last year was using the previous year's cars, wasn't it? So,
for the most part, yeah.
Yeah.
There were a couple missing as well. I think there wasn't the Super Impreza was missing. And I think too, the Lancer Evolution.
Ah, okay.
I think it didn't appear in the main WRC Championship, but it was in the junior class, I believe.
Mm.
I was a bit surprised to see that missing. Yeah, I mean, that's basically it for our suggestion of the Dirt Rally, I think. I think that's it. Oh, there's one for Alan. One last question from Nick on Twitter. How did you start making videos? I presume it was with a camera.
Yes, with a camera. Basically, how did I start making videos? I uploaded...
Back in 1989,
Yes, back years ago. I uploaded a video trailer to to YouTube. And then I thought, well, I got hold of an early game, and I thought, you know, for fun, I might just whack a video on YouTube. I thought there's no point, because YouTubers are so big and they've got millions of views. No one's going to watch my stuff. And my computer at the time, which I think I got the PC in 2004. So, you know, it was an older PC. I mean, it was 5 years old, but, you know, it wasn't good at processing video. It would take 2 or 3 hours to process a video in 360p.
Wow.
You know, maybe even 4 hours to process a video in 360p. So the quality wasn't great. And I got this, it's called a flip handheld camera, and it made it possible for me to make videos. And then after a couple of months of just doing odd videos here and there, I never spoke in a video ever. And then I did some talking during the Gran Turismo demo. And they released a demo of Indianapolis in 2009, I think. And I did some talking, and I said, people, what do you think? Do you like it? Want to do some talking? And they said, yes. And then, so I kept on knocking out these videos, and the views were okay. You know, and I hadn't realized that I'd been getting all these games and access to games way before other people for years. And, you know, suddenly I was making videos and people were watching them. And then it really exploded with Formula One 2010. And so from there, the problem is there was no YouTube revenue back then. So I couldn't afford a better camera. And so I was really struggling right up until 2011, when I was finally able to get a new camera, a microphone, and a new laptop to process the videos. And it was in 2011 that I went to HD, first to 720p, and then gradually improved from there. But it took a long time. I mean, I remember making the test drive videos. You know, it was taking, I think I was doing those in 720p, and each video was taking 12 hours to process. So, I mean, and some of them were taking 12 hours to upload. So I would literally edit the video and then leave it on overnight, get up in the morning, and the video would almost be done. I would upload that, film another one, do the same thing the next day. It was impossible for me to get a video up any quicker than that. So it was difficult getting started with very limited funds. And then monetizing the videos back then wasn't straightforward either, because if you weren't part of Machinima, you weren't allowed to basically monetize your videos. And it was, again, that caused a lot of stress with games publishers. Now they actually have letters saying you're allowed to monetize your videos. But back then, none of that existed. So it was hard work, but I got into it, I guess, by luck. Back to the question is, I got into it by just trying something. You know, it just came from nowhere. And I put my money into that little camera, and, you know, 4 million views later, I was able to upgrade. So, you know, I think if you want to do something on YouTube or Twitch, the main thing is just to make a stab at it, get started, and be committed with it. And eventually your audience will grow. And if you have the potential, then it will develop.
So there you have it. Yeah. What a very touching story. That is basically BBB in a nutshell.
Yeah.
Anyway, I think that's pretty much it for this podcast. Unless anyone has anything else to add.
Nope.
I think that's about it this week. I look forward to next week, and looking forward to the future of 2017. Wow, what a year. What a year we've got in store.
Right. That's it from us then. As Alan said, we'll be back next week with a look ahead of the year of what you can expect from the racing game genre. Until then, that is it from us. Thanks, as always, for watching, and we'll see you again next time. Goodbye.